Hello, I'm Jeremy, and welcome to another episode of Jeremy Hughes Reviews, where mistreated movies get a second chance. Today, I'll be making another video full of bite-sized reviews of movies and Netflix stuff that I've seen. This is Mini Reviews number 3. I always feel like Like I said in my fresh review, the woman in the house across the street from the girl in the window does a much better job balancing horror and comedy than that film, as unlike Fresh, which is basically a straight horror that occasionally remembers, oh yeah, I'm also a comedy, I guess, the woman never forgets that it's a comedy. It keeps a pretty good joke to scary stuff ratio, never going too far into either direction. The show has garnered some criticism for its more subtle approach to comedy, and while I can understand that not being everyone's cup of tea, I personally like the woman's subtler approach. It's very unique and still really works. The characters are also great. Kristen Bell is absolutely perfect as Anna. Not only does she bring the same likable charm and humor she brought to Eleanor Shellstrop from The Good Place, but the character herself is very interesting. While Anna is very likable and sympathetic, she's also not a very moral person, and the show does a good job of making you doubt her. Anna isn't a very reliable narrator, so even though we support her, we don't exactly believe her. And the other characters are great too. Sloane is very likable, and she's a good friend to Anna. Neil is a good red herring, as while he seems like a nice guy, he does have his dickish moments, and you can believe that not all is right with him. Emma, Neil's daughter, is very adorable. Buell is easily my favorite character, as he's just so adorable, and I love the running gag of him constantly working on Anna's mailbox. Carol is an alright character, and Brenda Koo does a good job in the role. And then there's Massacre Mike. See, Anna's daughter, Elizabeth, died at the hands of a serial killer named Massacre Mike, and he occasionally appears in flashbacks. And yet, despite this being a very small role, the guy playing Massacre Mike does an amazing job. He gives off the vibe of a guy who, on the outside, is just a nice guy twiddling his thumbs and minding his own business, but on the inside is a soul so dark he makes Satan look like Superman. It feels like at any moment he's about to crack and eat everyone, and you as the audience thank your lucky stars you're not in the same world as him. It's such a good performance. And the twist was genuinely jaw-dropping. I'm not going to spoil it, but I was legit shocked when I saw this twist. Let's just say that the killer isn't who you think it is. In short, the woman in the house across the street from the girl in the window is a really good Netflix original series. It's not an amazing show, but it is a very enjoyable experience. The characters are good, the acting is great, the comedy and scary stuff is well balanced, and I was engaged from episode 1 to the finale. I don't know if there's going to be a season 2 as the cliffhanger in the final episode implies, but I'd be interested in seeing one as this show is just really good. Check it out if you have Netflix. Fun, you're looking for fun! Yes, we're looking for fun! I never played Cuphead. It looked really cool with its old-timey, cartoony aesthetic and creative-looking characters, but the gameplay looked way too hard, especially in the boss levels. However, I was interested in a Cuphead TV show, as I still liked the overall aesthetic and look of the game, and thought that might translate well to the small screen. And after watching the Cuphead show, I have to say that, like the woman in the house, the Cuphead show is really good. It's a great show to put on when you want something fun and silly to help lift you up. The animation is really faithful to the game, having the same kind of aesthetic as well as a rubbery feel that makes the cartoony stuff land. And like the woman, the characters are great. Both Cuphead and Mugman are very mischievous, but are likable because at the end of the day, they're just naive children who are trying to navigate their crazy world, and they're both distinct from each other, as Cuphead is more adventurous and risk-taking, while Mugman is more shy and cautious, but still up for some fun. Elder Kettle is a very entertaining take on the Elder Caretaker character, as he can go from kind and caring to boiling mad in a millisecond. The Devil is a hilarious and menacing antagonist that feels like a cross between Squidward Tentacles and the red guy from Cow and Chicken, and there are a ton of awesome one-off characters. Ribs and croaks were really funny and worked well off each other. The vegetables were enjoyable. And I'm kind of upset that King Dice and Miss Chalice were only in one episode because they were great characters. Honestly, there's not that much to say about the Cuphead show, it's just a simple show with some fun humor, great characters, and a fantastic atmosphere. If you're a Cuphead fan, like old style cartoons, or feeling down, check out the Cuphead show. Just a great Netflix original series. And I'm so glad we're going to get more episodes soon. And while we're on the subject of video game adaptations, unlike Cuphead, I actually have played Postal 2, which this movie is based on. And it is an insanely fun game. Postal 2 is like if Goat Simulator and Family Guy had a baby. It's an incredibly enjoyable experience that I 100% recommend playing. And as for the movie, well, despite being directed by Uwe Boll, one of the worst directors ever, Postal the movie is really fun. It's very similar to Freddy Got Fingered, in that both movies are essentially a middle finger to the movie industry and good taste in general. Except while Freddy Got Fingered throws up its middle finger by having scenes of Tom Green being Tom Green and subversions of basic storytelling tropes, Postal does it by being as offensive as possible. Like, there is so much offensive stuff in this movie. But it works because the offensive stuff reaches the line without ever really crossing it. It goes there, don't get me wrong, but it never fully becomes unwatchable. On top of that, I like the characters. The Postal Dude, played by Zach Ward, who some might remember as Scott Farkas from A Christmas Story, is very likable and relatable, and plays a good straight man to the crazy stuff going on around him. Dave Foley of awesome comedy group Kids in the Hall is really entertaining as Postal Dude's sleazy con man cultist uncle, Uncle Dave. Chris Coppola does a good job playing Uncle Dave's right-hand man, Richie, giving a lot of energy and humor to the character. Vern Troyer plays himself, and he has some good lines. Uwe Boll also plays himself in a very funny director's cameo, not just because Boll has some funny lines, but because the character interviewing him said that Boll made his living turning video games into hit movies, which is easily one of the funniest jokes of the film. J.K. Simmons, yes, that J.K. Simmons, is hilarious as a conspiracy theory peddling lunatic. The bad guys are pretty funny, and the guy playing George W. Bush is doing a fantastic job. Like, that looks and sounds almost exactly like the real Bush. As for the comedy, it can be hit or miss, but it's generally hit, at least in my opinion. There are quite a number of funny jokes and moments in this movie, from clever lines to sight gags to crazy situations. The film just hits you with all sorts of ridiculous comedy. And in the second half, specifically when the gang gets inside the bunker, things go from crazy to absolute bananas. Like, it's just honestly insane. But the thing that makes Postal a great video game movie is how it treats the source material. The main reason video game movies fail is because, more often than not, they either stray so far away from the source material that it's virtually unrecognizable, or they do the opposite and try so hard to capture the source material that it confuses non-fans and sacrifices logic and consistency in favor of constant references to the original game or games. Postal does neither. While the movie does capture the original Postal 2 very well, it doesn't go overboard. In essence, Postal the movie is its own thing. And while there are definitely references to the original game, such as Postal Dude's wife, dude trying to get a job, the crotchy dolls, and even the cat shotgun, they don't overpower the script. The film knows how to perfectly balance its references without feeling like an overloaded pile of fan service. So yeah, Postal the movie is very enjoyable. It's not perfect, as it can sometimes be too offensive for its own good. It looks pretty cheap. The final shootout is a boring, disorienting mess. and the postal dude and his love interest have no chemistry. But those problems are balanced out by how unabashedly fun this movie is. I can definitely understand why people like Kyle Norty and Ed Egg don't like this movie, but I personally really liked how bonkers, unabashedly offensive, ridiculous, and enjoyable Postal was. And if you like Postal 2, Freddy Got Fingered, or movies that are absolutely bonkers, give this film a watch. I never thought I'd say this, but great job, Uwe Boll. You made a really good movie. It's not about the money, money, money. We don't need your money, money, money. We just want to make the world dance. Forget about the price tag. Money Plane is just absolutely beautiful. It's the type of film where just about everything is completely awful, but it forms together into an amazing coagulation of stupid awesomeness. Let's start with the plot. While the actual premise itself is nothing special, a bunch of guys get an order from another guy to steal money from a money plane, and no, that's not just a stupid title, they actually call it the Money Plane in movie, but the execution makes no sense whatsoever. The money that they're stealing is cryptocurrency, so they're essentially stealing digital money from a physical location somehow. The woman in the group poses as a flight attendant with very little suspicion, and there is so much confusing nonsense that happens in the second half that it's honestly hard to keep track. And it gets even more ridiculous from there. The characters in this are all stereotypes of stereotypes. The main guy, played by Adam Copeland, better known as the wrestler Edge, is every action movie protagonist cliche wrapped up into one character. He's confident, he has a family, he wants to do one last job, he's a good person, he sticks it to the bad guy. Every cliche you can think of, to the point where it borders on parody. Also, Edge's gang is a pile of forgettable no-names that are just cliches in human form. The passengers on the money plane are absolutely hilarious, from an over-the-top cowboy named J.R. Crockett to a guy named Ivan, who I just called Hipster Luke Bryan because he looks like if Luke Bryan was a hipster, to Joey Lawrence from Blossom. But by far the best character is Darius Emmanuel Grouch III. Also known as the Rumble, played by none other than Kelsey frickin' Grammer. Grammer is on full not giving an S mode, never leaving his patio, constantly spewing bad one-liners, and being so above everything that it's honestly hilarious. Also, the set design is cheap. There are a ton of stupid choices, like playing Russian roulette on a non-bulletproof plane, having a glass table on a moving vehicle, and playing what I can only describe as Seen It Snuff Film Edition, and the dialogue is just ridiculous. Bottom line, Money Plane is amazing. In a sea of films that are so boring and forgettable, Money Plane shines like a copper penny in the sunlight. Everything about it is so enjoyably awful, and it never overstays its welcome. I guarantee that in a couple of years, Money Plane will be one of those bad movies everybody is going to be talking about. I highly recommend checking it out and seeing the glorious mess that unfolds before you. Hopefully, we get more enjoyable trash like this in 2022. I recently saw Little Shop of Horrors at a virtual event, and my God, does this film still hold up. The set design is absolutely phenomenal, with each location brimming with personality. The songs are all awesome. The Audrey 2 puppet still looks really good. There is so much 80s charm. Both the theatrical and original endings are pretty cool, and the characters. These characters are awesome. Seymour is an incredibly likable and sympathetic protagonist, played beautifully by Rick Moranis. Audrey is a very sympathetic and likable character, given a lot of charm by Al Green. Mr. Mushnick is a good take on the boss character, as while he tries to run his business, he still cares about his employees. Steve Martin is enjoyably over the top as crazy dentist Orange Schvello, And Audrey, too, is an absolutely fantastic villain with a lot of menace and humor. And like I said, the Audrey 2 puppet still looks great. Even the side characters are fantastic. Christopher Guest plays the customer who first sees Audrey 2, and he's hilariously weird. The late John Candy appears as a radio host, and easily the best one, Bill Murray as a dentist patient who enjoys going to the dentist way too much. Little Shop of Horrors is just such a great film. The comedy, the music, the effects, the characters, all of it, just absolutely fantastic. Easily one of the best movie musicals of all time, and a film that absolutely needs to be seen. Definitely check it out. Aqua Teen Hunger Force is a show that I've always known about, but never really thought to check out. But after watching an episode at a virtual event, I decided to look at the Aqua Teen Hunger Force movie and... yeah, I freaking loved it. Unlike films like The Simpsons Movie, South Park Bigger Longer and Uncut, and Beavis and Butthead Do America, which feel very cinematic despite being based on TV shows, Aqua Teen Hunger Force : Movie Film for Theaters, awesome title by the way, is basically just a longer episode of the show. And for any other show, that would be a bad thing. But for a show like Aqua Teen Hunger Force that's incredibly unstructured, bizarre, and virtually has no plot, it actually really fits. As someone who loves shows and movies that are grounded in as little reality as possible, I love how this movie is so bonkers and unpredictable. Colin Movie Film also reminds me a lot of Detective Heart of America, The Final Freedom. Because while that film has more of a plot than this one, they both revolve around anthropomorphic, inanimate objects and have a similar kind of humor. The characters are also pretty funny. While Master Shake is a bit of a jerk, he still manages to be a funny jerk. Meatwad is a good example of a stupid character done right. And Frylock is easily my favorite character as he has a really good voice, and I love how he's the straight man to all the insanity going on. The animation is also really good. There's a really cool, stylized feel to it that makes the humor land and makes it feel visually distinct. However, there are three problems with the film. The opening gag with the food playing rock songs in a subversion of the Let's All Go to the Lobby jingle is funny at first, but they drag the gag out for way too long. The stuff with Frylock actually being a woman comes out of left field and isn't really handled that well, and the film really doesn't know whether it wants to be a straightforward origin story for the trio or another random Aqua Teen Hunger Force episode, leading to one of the most convoluted endings I've ever seen. But overall, this was a fun watch. Aqua Teen Hunger Force : Movie Film for Theaters is a film that's as random as humanly possible and is really only able to be enjoyed if you're a fan of the show or if you love films that have as little grounding as possible. If you're not one of those two, then this film is not for you. But otherwise, check it out. You might have fun with this. And for those wondering, I have seen a couple more episodes since seeing this film, and I am now an Aqua Teen Hunger Force fan. Cat Burglar is a very fun interactive cartoon that, like the Cuphead show, beautifully captures the feel of an old-fashioned cartoon. The animation is very stylized and cool, capturing the vintage style of old Looney Tunes shorts while still feeling like its own thing. The humor and timing are incredibly faithful to an old-fashioned Tom and Jerry-esque cartoon, and Rowdy and Peanut are both really good characters. Rowdy is very expressive and enjoyable, and Peanut is likable, but without being so likable that we feel bad for him for stealing the painting. And both characters have great chemistry with each other. They both exhibit a lot of comedic energy and are both very funny and likable. I also love the many different endings and stuff to explore. There are so many crazy death scenes, different obstacles, and different jokes to explore and see, so every experience is completely different. As for the interactive element, it's really cool. Basically, every time Rowdy does something, there are three trivia questions on screen. Get them all right, and you move on to the next stage. Get even one wrong, and you lose a life. These trivia questions are not only really funny, but also make the experience tense, as they're extremely short and you never know when you can slip up. It's very cool. Cat Burglar is just a really funny Netflix cartoon, with a lot of humor, heart, and replay value. I highly recommend this to anyone who's a fan of old-fashioned cartoons. Great job, Netflix. I'd love to see you make more stuff like this in the future. I wouldn't blame you if you hadn't heard of spoof based on a true movie, as it is pretty obscure. But you should definitely check it out, as it's a really enjoyable film. It's a comedic anthology film, however, unlike Scare Package in the House, I won't break down the individual segments, as there's like 100 and they all have like one punchline. And while that description makes the film sound underwhelming, there are two things that make spoof work. One, the fact that these sketches don't go on for too long. A common problem of comedy sketches is that they go on too long for them to be funny. Movie 43 and most SNL movies are great examples of this. However, the sketches in spoof just come in, do their joke, and move on, just like that. And two, there's just such a kitschy charm to it. There's an enjoyable cheapness to spoof that really makes it endearing, from the simplistic animation, to the constant use of Comic Sans, to the homemade sets. It's a film that demonstrates how a lower budget can make a movie more enjoyable rather than appearing lazy. Also, the sketches are hilarious. The film takes aim at many movies, from Indiana Jones to the Texas Chainsaw Massacre, to the Pink Panther, to Rocky, to Jaws, to the Blair Witch Project. And as you can tell from the poster, there are some James Bond parodies thrown in. And all of them are really funny. The jokes are very simple, but they're effective and do their jobs quite nicely. Overall, spoof based on a true movie is a very fun, charming gem of a film that's really unlike anything I've ever seen. I can't really find it anywhere other than Tubi TV, so if you have Tubi TV, check it out. It's definitely a spoof film that's worth a couple of laughs. And that's it. Thanks for watching, and be sure to watch new videos when I make them. Till then, see ya!